The following podcast contains spoilers and explicit language. Listener discretion is advised. Welcome to Animated Anarchy, the show that takes a critical look at animated features of all kinds to determine the good and the bad. Hello, I'm Andrew Dickman.
And I'm Mike Ruocco.
And welcome once again to another episode where we talk about robots that are pretty much dying.
They're not really in disguise either. They're kind of out in the open.
Yeah, they're pretty much everywhere. But if you haven't guessed already, we're talking about...
Ferngully, that's right. Ferngully.
No, it's the Transformers movie. Not the Michael Bay ones, but the original one from 1986.
Six.
Right? Yeah. And we have a special guest with us today, Steve Yerko.
More than meets the eye.
Yes.
Yeah. This is my fault. This really is all my fault.
Actually, it is. And we
actually, it is.
No, we kind of had a plan to... I mean, we have a huge list of movies that we're going to see, regardless of what we plan or anything. But the Transformers movie is one of those movies where it's like... you know, we kind of need an expert on this, and and Steve was very, very much eager to
insistent.
Persistent. Very eager.
Well, this was back when you guys started the show, and Mike had to take some time off, and you had some guests on, and I said, like, hey, if Mike's ever out of town, you need a movie and a guest. Transformers the movie, me.
Yeah,
and I refused to leave.
No, we kind of needed to figure out our plans and how to do this, and honestly, like I think it would have been best to wait for it because this week was the 30th anniversary.
No, the 30th anniversary was a month ago.
Oh, we missed it. What's the point? Stop.
Damn.
But as of this recording, the first American Blu-ray release has, you know, just happened.
Yeah, it came out on Blu-ray. Mm-hmm. So, what better time to review it than now? So,
right, a month ago.
So it was either that or The Secret of Nim 2. Electric Boogaloo.
Robots don't die in that movie.
Yeah. We needed some robot death in our lives, so yeah, certainly. And this one did,
and this one
provide,
I think,
quite a bit.
I like the chemistry of it because of this particular, when we watched it, because Steve knows a lot about Transformers.
I know a decent amount.
And
Andrew knows...
I know a little bit.
A little bit.
I know a little bit.
Absolutely nothing about Transformers.
Shit.
All I know is that they're Transformers, they're robots in disguise, Optimus Prime is the main Autobot, and Megatron is the main Decepticon.
I like how when we were watching it, it was like, which one's itchy? Which one's that one? Is that one
like,
Optimus?
I know there's what? Soundwave and Starscream and... Bumblebee.
There's a huge cast of robots, toys.
But it's great because they say their names a whole bunch of times. It's not like the Michael Bay movies where it's just like, who's that piece of sharp
metal?
Broken piece of metal?
Amalgamation of gears and wires kind of clinking together.
Yeah, I don't want to talk about those movies too much. But one thing I got to say is I talk about this movie a lot, and it's just a constant thing now. Every time I say Transformers the movie, I don't say... The Transformers, or Transformers, hey, Transformers the movie. Everyone's like, Michael Bay? I'm like, no! The one from 1986? God! The one that existed before I was even born!
No! Not that one!
But I made sure to ask Mike, is there any questions you have before going into this? Anything you need to clear up? And, like, you knew everything, but it just reminded me of a time I was...
There's not, honestly, going into it, there's not really a whole bunch you need to know.
It's straightforward, right?
Kind of.
More or less, I think.
More or less. Well, the thing was, is that the first thing going in was like, oh, look, it's Hot Rodimus. And it's like, I already know about Hot Rod. And it was like, you said, like, this was his first appearance.
Yeah.
And I was just like, wait a minute, so he wasn't in the show before this? That would, nope. And especially in the way that they portrayed him, he's just like right next to a kid, and he's fishing with him, and it's like, oh, hey, this is normal. It's like, hey, Hot Rod, I love fishing with you, and I can just imagine someone coming into this movie, it's just like, who's that?
Yeah,
why are they so chummy?
It's all genius marketing. There's one thing I want to say about just like clearing everything up. Obviously, you guys you knew plenty. I was such a huge Transformers fan when I was younger in high school. And by the way, I was in high school in the early 2000s.
Yeah.
Which is really, it's weird to say.
I was honestly too young for this movie. Yeah. I mean, for me, I mean, 86, I was like probably 4 years old. Mm-hmm. And the first movie that I've ever seen in theaters, I think, was the Jetsons movie. It was probably something else. I think it was like The Land Before Time or Secret of Nim or something like that, or a Disney movie. I can't remember.
Mine was according to my parents, mine was Five Will Goes West.
Yeah. I cannot honestly pinpoint the exact movie that I first saw in theaters, but I do remember. No one ever can. Yeah. I do remember the theater that I did see these movies in. And that's pretty much it. I know that Dragon's Lair was out at the time. It's one of those things where it's just like, you know, you kind of have to pick and choose which things you've been exposed to. And Transformers wasn't necessarily a show that I grew up with either. Mm-hmm. So really, my memories are very vague about, I know that Transformers existed. I have a lot of the toys. But purely on the basis of I like robot stuff, and Transformers are like the perfect robot toy. So being a kid and growing up with the show and everything, I mean, I'm sure it's like it was like a blast.
Yeah, so it's weird because for me, like, I grew up with Transformers, but I grew up in the 90s, and by then the original TV show was done. It was in syndication, and they introduced what was, you know, and that's now referred to as Generation One, and they came up with Generation 2, which was...
Generation 2 was after the movie, right?
Yeah, it was just them repainting a lot of the toys, coming up with new toys, and I grew up with those. So I always knew what Transformers were. Mm-hmm. And then, they came out with a series back in 2001. It was called Transformers Robots in Disguise. It was an anime that was dubbed and aired on Fox Kids.
I have to say that a lot of my exposure to Transformers was those CG movies because I was watching a lot of TV at the time, and those would happen to be on Cartoon Network or something like that. And this was before Transformers animated series. Mm-hmm. And I can't say that going into those was necessarily good because they're Beast Wars was also another thing.
Yeah, I grew up on Beast Wars. I forgot to say Beast Wars was really the Transformers series I grew up on.
I would honestly say my biggest exposure to Transformers would be Beast Wars. Yeah. And I necessarily don't like that show myself, but I know that I watched a lot of it.
Oh, yeah.
So it was like one of those things that was like, it's on, I have to watch it, and it's all right, but it's not for me.
Yeah, like Beast Wars was my series, and I still knew like the original characters, but like I could barely remember anything about Transformers. So when they started incorporated like the original series into it, I was like losing my mind.
Right.
So like I've always been a fan, but like then they started bringing over some of those Japanese series and dubbing them, and you know I'm still young. I just like robots that turn into cars.
But what's great about the series is that generation to generation, it's like it's still exposed to people.
Yeah.
And that leads people to want to see the previous versions, and thankfully those are available to people.
So available now.
But having it available to people who are interested into it, like in modern times, you kind of start to get a realization. It's either, oh God, this really sucked, or wow, I really like this. I liked what they used to have.
Yeah.
As opposed to what they have now, which I still like, it's you know, it's one of those things where it's you're exposed to something and then you appreciate the previous versions of it. So that's something that can be said about Transformers in itself.
Yeah,
I mean, say what you want about the Michael Bay movies, they kind of expose people to the Transformers in general, which kind of I mean, honestly, that's really how I got more into Transformers, was because of those movies.
I was already super into Transformers when I remember being excited for a live-action movie. Now it's like, God, by the time that fourth one came out, I couldn't get over the fact that me being such a huge Transformers fan at one point, that I was seeing Jersey Boys instead with my mother than going to see the fourth Transformers movie next door. I'm like, what a sad realization.
I remember being, I don't know if you were there, but I remember, because Steve and I went to college together. Mm-hmm. And I remember being at the school, and just we heard that Michael Bay was doing a Transformers. We heard it. The first one didn't even come out yet, I think.
No, the first one came out before we were even college.
Really?
It came out, yeah.
Like 2007?
Came out our senior year of high school, 2007.
Oh, yeah. So we were hearing that they were doing more.
Yes.
I think that was the conversation. We were like, yeesh.
The second one was just atrocious.
It's Transformers are still relevant, but it just blows my mind. I just think back because I was such a huge fan, and I remember my animation class in high school, where it was kind of like, you know, you have to at least do one project. It's like, pick an animated series and do a presentation on it. And most of it's like, this was Family Guy was made by Seth MacFarlane. Seth MacFarlane worked on Johnny Bravo. Family Guy is funny. The end. And I was such a huge Transformers fan, but like I did my research because I know I'm like, well, there's a backstory to this. Of course, it's a big market.
And it's such a weird thing to have a backstory to it, too. It's like, I have a thing called the Ark. It's basically a Bible, for the Transformers themselves, like the history before the Transformers were Transformers or even a toy line. Mm-hmm. And it's like, wow, what a weird, like... What a weird culture
robots
we have.
That turn into trucks and
it was
cassette
like,
players. Like,
I mean, I have friends in the animation industry who have basically, I mean, they took Japanese toys and used those as like, here, this is what we're doing right now.
Yeah.
We're making these toys. Mm-hmm. And then they just had to apply that to a cartoon.
Yeah. Hasbro pretty much came in. They're like, well, these two companies are making these toys. We're going to just, you know, get the rights to produce all these toys and then just make a series about it.
And by that,
yeah,
we have like a huge history
now.
Yeah. So it's so, but it's so weird to think.
It just reminds me though, I just want to get this one story in high school in this animation class. And I at one point when it's like, oh, we're doing a stop motion, I brought in all my Transformers toys and I had a good friend that I was buddied up with, but I practically could have just done that on my own because I made stop motion movies as a kid.
Mm.
And you know, like I'll use that term loosely. But I was like, the only thing was like, oh, just make a clay character and then animate that. I'm like, well, can we bring in other stuff? And my teacher's like, yeah, go nuts.
Yeah, whatever.
And I brought in all my Transformers toys. I'm like, yeah, I made a clay character.
Yeah,
and I just
done
had
that
to
before.
Get caught in the middle of a battle between Autobots and Decepticons and just getting destroyed.
Working with action figures
and
doing stuff.
Oh, it's a blast.
I did that myself. That was fun.
But when I'm talking about the presentation, because of course I chose Transformers, but I thought, I'm like, well, I could actually get a decently length presentation about this, talk about the toys and the concept and all that, and I played a clip.
You basically you were an overachiever, went above and beyond about this.
Well,
because it's something that you're into.
I was like one of like three actual artists in that animation class. But I took a clip from like the original pilot of Transformers, was Optimus Prime and Megatron just fighting at a dam. And I played that clip. No introduction. Like, that's why I asked you. I said, like, is there anything you need to know? And you were good. I played that clip. After explaining what the concept of Transformers is, and the first thing I hear was, I don't get it. What was going on? I was like, are you joking? It was two robots. One was good and one was evil. They're fighting. They're toys. Why are you thinking hard about this? And I'm the fan! Like, I'm so aware that, like... Transformers is just a big marketing scheme, but it's just it's like Star Wars too.
Yeah.
Like it's become something bigger than that, but it's still when you look and read between the lines, it is what it is.
I just find it fascinating because there's so many different interpretations to this one thing that just was a corporate shill for merchandising.
But for me, Transformers was just every time I'd see Transformers anything, not even so much the toys, just Transformers. I'd be like, some poor bastard had to animate in perspective robots transforming into cars and explosions and animated backgrounds. Like, we just watched this movie.
They
and I'm literally
cheat that sometimes, which is funny.
And we were watching this movie, and I've never seen it before.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm like, just Jesus fucking Christ. Like, to animate, like... Yeah.
The this, first
this,
scene.
There's a scene with this giant asshole.
Let's get into the movie. Yeah.
So there's this giant asshole flying through space with
the
rings.
The year is 2005.
It's the year.
Oh, yeah, that was great.
The yeah.
The year is 2005.
The thing is passing past camera.
You don't remember that? It was just like a couple years ago.
Yeah.
And it just passes by camera, and there's all these... shiny these bolts and little things, and then it goes away in perspective and you just see it floating away. Some poor bastard has to try to in between and draw that.
Yeah.
And it's like, that would make I would just drop a pencil and be like, well, I'm done.
It was funny because when we were watching this, I first said, I was like, wow, this is like, it's almost like Akira. And then you mentioned to me, it's like, oh yeah, Akira came after this, like years afterwards. And I'm so bad with my dates and everything. It's like, I could have sworn Akira was way before that.
Nah, but late 80s.
But yeah, it's like, this was pretty much Japanese animation.
Yeah.
I mean, Toei, so... Yeah, I mean, they did a bang up job with it. I mean, it's not perfect, but it's honestly, looking at it, it's impressive. There's a giant orange space asshole in floating in space, going toward a robotic planet that is just nothing but garbled. I mean, we talk about the movies, the Michael Bay movies, and how there's like just.
Noise.
Noise. Yeah. It's mechanical noise. And
those are just the characters.
And these are like, those are just the characters. But it's like, you see like a giant planet, and you think about all of the drawing that has gone into, it's a traditional animated feature. So, so looking at that is, first off, it's impressive. And we talk about this all the time, how it's like, do you do it to be impressive, or do you do it because it's like necessary? You know, I mean, it's like this is an entirely different subject altogether.
My eyes were crossing watching that scene.
Yeah, seeing like a planet being sucked into a sphincter of it's just like,
okay, Unicron is a planet. Okay. Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
He eats things through what looks like an asshole. It never stops being funny.
I know, but it's...
For people that don't know, because I'm sure some of your listeners are probably rolling their eyes that you're doing this movie for this episode. It's my fault, everybody, if you're still listening.
No, but the thing that kind of blows me away, too, is that... two things. One, it's really well animated, and it's... Orson Welles' last role as an actor.
Yeah.
And he died, I think, before the movie
a
came out?
A month after he was done recording, I believe.
Yeah. And just to think that his last thing he ever did was a giant planet-devouring ball that farts light.
Man, character actors, man.
Character actors.
Yeah. Going into it, it's like, I mean, I knew the cast going in, but it was funny that Steve, like, when you first, this is like your first viewing of this
movie. I've never seen this movie before.
So, the opening credits are basically just all the celebrity names that came up, and it was basically, Mike, what were you impressed with?
I was impressed with the fact that, like, it was like Scatman Crothers... and Robert Stack, the unsolved mysteries guy.
Yeah.
And like, so Frank Welker does like, what, like 20 voices in that movie? He doesn't get credit, but the Micro Machines guy gets credit. Judd Nelson.
Oh, yeah.
Like, all these people. And then, I knew about the Orson Welles thing beforehand. Because I always love thinking.
That's so well known.
I always think about last movies that renowned actors have done. Like, I just recently rewatched American Tail 2, and that was Jimmy Stewart's last role was a burping cowboy dog who burps. And then like Don Knotts, he was the mayor turkey in Chicken Little.
That's right. Yeah.
And he was like, it's like these people who are so like Lauren Bacall, who's one of my favorite actresses, her last thing she ever did was she was a voice on Family Guy. As like, I think she was like hitting on Peter. It's really creepy, but it's like I always think it's so amusing and sad when you see this a very renowned actor do not a shitty movie per se, but it's usually an animated movie and they play a very strange character. In the case of Orson Welles, it's a giant planet-devouring robot.
Mm-hmm.
That
like Lionel Stander and Eric Idle's in this.
Yeah, movie. Eric Idle. It's like Eric Idle plays. Was it Retgar?
Yeah, Retgar, and we'll get it. Yeah. Leonard Nimoy's in this. I mean, they put a nod in the third movie with Leonard Nimoy voicing. It's just funny because who was Megatron voiced by? It was Frank
Welker.
That was Frank Welker. And then there's that transition where it's from Frank Welker to Leonard Nimoy when he does that transformation. We'll get into it. But yeah, the first scene is we basically see this giant orb from space devouring a planet, which is pretty menacing when you think about it. It's like all of a sudden a planet is destroyed by another planet. And then all of a sudden we're on Earth and we see all of your favorites, Optimus.
Oh, we're actually on Cybertron's moons.
Oh, on Cybertron's moons, right.
Moon base.
Here's the thing. It's like I was kind of confused to where everything was in relationship
They were on a moon base and then they wanted to get in contact with Autobot City, which is on Earth?
Okay. Yeah.
All right, yeah, please, Steve, this was
the confusion. It is the year 2005. The treacherous Decepticons have retaken their home planet of Cybertron. But meanwhile, on Cybertron's moons, the Autobots plan to reclaim their homeland.
Yeah, so there was... Yeah, okay.
How many times have I seen
this? So really, yeah, it was the Decepticons have taken over Cybertron and the Autobots are trying to get it back.
Which doesn't make sense to me because there was always like only like 10 Decepticons on the show and like 40 freaking Autobots. And I think probably how they took back the home planet is all the Autobots kept coming to Earth and like, I want to be a sports car. And Megatron's probably like, no one's on Cybertron anymore.
Yeah.
let's go home and take it back.
I'm a gun.
Yeah. I only knew that Shockwave was like constantly on Cybertron. That was like the only thing that I... And he appears a couple times.
He's pretty much the DD of the Decepticons.
Right. So, So Optimus, basically, they have this plan to take over, but they were spied on by one of the other Decepticons. And so... some of them are on this spaceship that is about to go to Earth.
Yeah, pretty much. It was like, we don't have enough energy to power like an attack on the Decepticons. Mm-hmm. Let's go to our newly created city on Earth where we mine all this energy.
Yeah, Earth is involved. Yeah. So okay, that base that they were on was
which is funny because base. One of the trailers say it's like it all takes place on Earth. It only the first act.
That's right. Really. Yeah. So that's where everyone is in relationship to each other, and so the Decepticons find this out, led by Megatron, and they go to this ship. And practically just murder. Just outright, like, one-shot murder all of these Autobots.
Let's paint the picture here. you're a little kid.
Yes.
You watch the first season of Transformers, you love it.
Mm-hmm.
You like some of these characters. You bought some of the toys of the characters you like. Yeah. Now you're seeing them on the big screen. Like, maybe you saw, Return of the Jedi.
Some of them that are really recognizable. Yeah. I mean, like I personally could point out certain ones. Yeah. There was
they're not full fleshed characters. No pun intended.
No, but they're toys. Kids love them. It still means something to them.
They're iconic, but so it's like, oh, you're so excited. You're seeing them in a grander scale. The animation looks fantastic. And then you're on the shuttle and it's led by guys like Ironhide and Prowl who've been there since the first episode.
Mm-hmm.
And everything kind of, everything you thought you knew gets changed when Megatron yells his battle cry of, "Die, Autobots!" And they start dying!
Yeah. Because in the show, it's like when they're fighting each other, it's just like, back and forth thing.
It's like stormtroopers. They're either always missing their shots, or if they do get shot, they're like, oh, retreat.
Yeah. But in this one, they just like, I mean, watching it, it is pretty devastating. It's just like watching, like, holy crap.
Yeah.
Like, almost immediately into the movie as well, I should add.
Oh,
It's like we're not even minutes into the movie, and now... characters that you recognize are dying off.
It's not just that random planet.
In droves.
Yeah.
As well. It's like... it's pretty...
And they get more gruesome. Like, Prowl is a very
This iconic... is like an immediate mood switch. It's like, it's like complete 180. You think something nice is going to happen, or like, it's just going to be like a, oh, hey, this is the back and forth sort of thing.
Like,
No, Starscream and Megatron, just outright murder. But and also... mercilessly.
Yeah.
Because Ironhide is just like, no! And he's like trying to like beg for mercy or something, and Megatron's just like...
Or just trying to stop him with his last of energy, and Megatron blows his head off. Prowl, the police car, gets shot, and just this look of just pain as he dies, and like smoke comes out of his mouth, and it's...
Yeah.
It's crazy. It's it crazy, because this like, was just a character who's just like, this going into, good guy.
Like, going in, not having any previous experience with watching Transformers, I just was sitting there imagining, being like, oh, I can't wait to see my favorite Transformer on screen, and then the first minute you see him, you're like, hey, it's... And they're dead.
Yeah.
Like, I felt bad for every child that was in that theater... What is it? How many years ago? 30 years ago?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Jesus.
Let's take a step back. Why are all these robots dying? This movie is, of course, a marketing scheme to promote a new line of toys.
Yeah, they didn't really think of it that way.
Yeah, the new season. So they're like, we got to introduce new characters. Well, what are we going to do with these old ones that we're not... that are being discontinued? Like, oh, well, let's just kill them off. Most of the time, characters just get... written off, like they're never seen.
Yeah, they just disappear. We don't talk to them again. We don't talk about them.
But this one, like, they actually thought, like, well, why don't we just do something grand scale? Why don't we just like kill them off? Yeah. And it wasn't just like everyone was like, yeah, okay. The director of this movie, Nelson Shin, who worked on the actual series, believe it or not, was very much against this. He was like, "You can't kill." Like, well, we'll get to it later.
Well, yeah, because I'm very sure he's very series minded in that sense.
Well, not even that. He was just they thought about like the. Like the
gruesomeness.
They thought about the children. Yeah. But they thought, like, you have these gruesome. Kids attach themselves to these characters.
Yeah.
So, yeah, this whole thing was just to make way for these new toys.
But it's okay in grand fashion. It's okay because they're robots.
That's
never what
happened. That's another thing. It's like everything in this movie that dies is a robot.
Yes.
And that is also That is like S&P.
Why not the child? Kill the child.
Oh, poor Daniel.
Daniel sucks.
Oh, Daniel.
I hope.
And Spike. I was just like, okay, yeah, Spike. And those characters are just part of the series as well, but they're not really characters that you care about. They're just there for a relation. They're
the human avatar, just to be like, kids.
Pretty much.
And you're like Spike.
That's what happens.
Jazz and Optimus Prime.
And that's a mentality of a cartoon show anyway. Yeah. It's like, we need something that will relate to the kids.
Which I never get, because no one ever gives a crap about
the characters. No, we don't. And we've talked about this before. It's usually like, you know, a grade schooler would look more highly up to a high schooler than it would their own grade. Sure. And a high schooler would much more likely look up to a college student than a high schooler. So it's like, it's the progression of age and where they aspire to be something else than what they are
now. So a 5-year-old looks at an 8-year-old and watches robots die?
Basically.
Yeah.
Okay.
So,
moving on. Yeah. That was a complete, like, on the side.
Oh, there's so many.
So robots, more robots die, et cetera,
well,
et cetera.
Now it's like we're in the middle of the first act. They go to Earth, and it's this huge battle in Autobot City, which is like the big home base on this planet.
Mm-hmm.
And it's...
It gets into this huge kerfuffle. Optimus comes in later.
Yeah, to save the day.
To pretty much save the day. And there's a really... I have to say something. This movie is like just nonstop action.
I finally realized that when you said that while we were watching, I'm like, yeah, this movie doesn't really slow down.
No, it doesn't.
It's kind of like Mad Max, where there's just a set piece every 2 or 3 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah. I think the only time that it actually slows down is the part that we're going to get to. Let's just say that Optimus and Megatron have a huge... one-on-one battle.
Yeah.
Which is the epic, fight.
Now's a good time to mention, this is the first time we hear the song, The Touch.
Stan Bush. Yeah.
It's a very iconic song at this point now. Yeah,
being very... I mean, I'm very into 80s stuff.
Yeah.
And I love 80s music.
Yeah, me too.
This The soundtrack is incredible in this.
Yeah.
Misplaced, though, some of those
songs. In some areas, yeah. I mean, it's kind of like we need a soundtrack to go over something. But it's but at the same time, it's a really good soundtrack.
It feels like heavy metal where it's just, like, they make a movie and then they just litter the background with 80 songs.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, so. I don't know if you guys really picked up on this, but the score is done by Vince DiCola, who did the Rocky IV score previously.
Yeah.
And I love the score, first of all, I love the way it sounds, but the way it syncs up to the action and the tone and what's going on screen, I think it's fascinating.
Mostly when
it's
there is action.
It's so great.
During the action scenes, yes. I would say probably the most. But then there's moments where it's like, character is down and this really pumped up music is happening. And
well, there's a lot of arena rock, too. Like heavy metal stuff. And that was...
It is a of-the-time sort of thing to do. And I can't really... I can't say there's a whole lot of movies where I can say they've done that, but... If there's any movies that I could give off examples for, this would be one of them. Mm-hmm. So, really, I mean, the soundtrack itself is a memorable thing.
Yeah.
So, really, I have to give them props for it. So, and there's a lot of moments where it really pumps you up. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, you got the touch. Like, whenever that shows up, I'm just like, oh, yeah. Yeah, that's
and, and it shows up twice in the movie.
Yeah.
Yeah, quite a few times.
Both incredibly fitting. It's like, it could have easily just sounded like a Danny Elfman Disney score. Mm-hmm. But it's
something... Dare to Be Stupid is in this Weird Al song. Yeah, Weird Al. Which, honestly, it's like, I can see it. I can see it working because Weird Al was a big thing at the time. And the thing that is happening at the time is kind of stupid in a way.
Yeah, it's silly.
So it's silly, and it's a really, I mean, it's one of my favorite Weird Al songs. Mm-hmm. But when you hear it, it's just like, oh, it's a Weird Al song. It's like trying to fit it in with the rest of the soundtrack, which is like very, it's kind of
robots
serious.
Dying.
Yeah, I mean, like, I would say, like, there's a lot of moments in the soundtrack where it's like, we're trying to take this seriously. And then a Weird Al, I mean, you know Weird Al to be silly and everything. So it's like, that kind of, like, changes the concept of the soundtrack for a little bit. But also, it's like, that scene is very Mad Max-y. The characters are kind of dumb. And, you know, it's trying to fit in the idea of the scene. So it's very fitting for what it is. I personally just love the sound of it. I really don't have much bad to say about it. Some of it is a little ill-paced, but for the most part, I mean, I would want the soundtrack. Just listen. Oh, yeah. Just watching the movie, I was just like, "Wow, I really like that song. Mm-hmm. I like that song. Brad, I want the soundtrack."
Even their interpretation of the Transformers theme—it's just this heavy metal theme.
Yeah,
that's my hype song.
That's a really that music. See, it's music that really just like it's supposed to get you charged up.
Yeah,
so it works.
Uh huh.
So I'm all for it.
It's not something like, "Geez, I saw the Suicide Squad movie, that was so influenced after like Guardians of the Galaxy came out and how they incorporated that soundtrack."
Well, that's the
but
thing
it was just
about,
like, let's just put all these songs. The lyrics go with what these characters are like. It's like, this is too much. Slow down.
Well, yeah, that's the thing about Guardians of the Galaxy is that it's not only that they're using music like that, it also sets a tone.
Yes.
And it really kind of helps move the story forward.
Yeah.
And also kind of like, it pumps you up.
Uh-huh.
So it makes you feel for the movie, and it's not just like, it's not like an ill place.
Like,
just put in as much as we can.
Yeah,
like a lot of movies do. They get a certain band or something involved in a movie, and they're saying a lot of Disney movies are like that. They say like, well, let's get Sting involved with this movie, and he'll like do the entire soundtrack. And while that's fitting, it's like sometimes it's overdone, and sometimes it doesn't fit. You know,
I immediately think of DreamWorks Home.
That's what I was just like.
It's another Rihanna song.
Right.
It doesn't like that would take me out of the movie.
Yeah, That actually brings me back to, like, when I saw Home, it's like when I was watching that, and every time a Rihanna song came up, it was like, this doesn't feel like it should be there.
This doesn't feel like how people act.
And also, yeah. If there's a serious moment in the movie that's a strong character moment,
yes,
they'll just, like, I can imagine someone in a sound editing booth just reaching for the volume control on the music and then just turning it up.
So yeah, that's another thing. It drowns out the rest of the action.
And then they lower it back down when things slow down again.
Mm-hmm.
Are you talking about
Home?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. The volume, whenever a Rihanna song came up, they just like ramped it up and everything else was just drowned out.
So then in Home, her mother gets taken away. So talking about Transformers. No, yes. This first act is... I think of it as, hey, if you really love the cartoon, like, this is your scene. Despite seeing more iconic characters who don't even get killed on screen, you just see their dead corpses.
Not to mention, there's a lot of characters that just, all of a sudden, it's like, oh my god, Wheeljack!
Yeah.
It's like, we didn't even see him fight.
Yeah.
He's just like, died off screen or something. Mm-hmm. It's just like, whoa, that's...
insane. And more characters were gonna get killed off.
Yeah. This
budget. The
entire scene what you're talking about is like there are a lot of like memorable lines as well that I remember. I mean, just are touted out
mm-hmm.
because they're so culturally appropriate and it's like
Reaganomics.
No, but it's like you hear them outside of the movie. I didn't know this is where it came from. I thought it was always from the show, not the movie.
No.
So, really, I mean, there's something to say about this movie and it being very memorable, and there's a lot of memorable stuff to it. So, you know, there's not really much. Speaking of memorable, Optimus Prime versus Megatron, it's like they start fighting, and then there's like Megatron's last legs. Optimus is on his last legs, and he's just Optimus is like shot down, and Megatron is like carried off by a sound wave and everything.
Yeah.
So they retreat, and
both are fatally wounded.
Yeah, both are fatally wounded, and there's the scene where Optimus is like on his deathbed, literally his deathbed. And he is talking to Rodimus and
the new characters.
None of the old characters are there. Yeah, and that's another thing. It's like
Perceptor.
these are new characters that are really they haven't really been introduced in the show or anything. Mm-hmm. So I can see this kind of being also jarring.
Yeah, you got to think of how traumatizing that is because hey, everything you knew and loved.
Yeah, who are these assholes?
They're dying, and look at them. They feel sad about it, and it's like feel sorry. For them, like, no, they weren't in the trenches with us. Yeah. Like, I mean, they were for this movie.
Speaking of emotional, it's like, this movie doesn't personally move me in the way that it does other people. Because first off, I didn't see this in theaters. I wasn't familiar with the show. But knowing that this scene makes grown men cry, and to be fair, if you... knowing like a character like Optimus Prime and his power and his like intensity of character, the scene is very well paced and very well dramatized. In that, you know, he's dying, he gives off his final words. He's still very, you know, he's still very powerful and like a leader.
This is the main character.
Yeah, the main character
is getting killed off in the first act,
and he's dead. He's dying. He's dead. And he even goes grayscale, which is kind of it's like how much more can we emphasize that this character is dead?
No, that's the thing. They were already planning for the next season, and this was an episode that did happen. Where he gets resurrected as an out-of-control zombie. And he's like, Rodimus, you have to kill me. And it's like... because they probably... at the time, they didn't think this was traumatizing. And they probably thought, like, well, if we bring him back as, like, kind of like a corpse, you know, that must be stopped. Yeah. That's probably not traumatizing either.
And they think about, well, maybe we should...
All my circuits will be right back after these messages.
They're robots, but they have a spark, man.
Yeah. And but, also, this is the first introduction to that Matrix of Leadership thing.
Yeah,
that
it introduces more lore that was just made up for this movie.
Yeah, just...
pretty much the...
Let me take out my chest cavity and, like, just give you this orange in a vice.
Here,
in a
take
vice.
My glowing bop it and put it...
This is basically the MacGuffin of the entire movie, this Matrix of Leadership thing. It's
so
like,
we never really know why.
No, we don't. We're just told, like, you know, there's something special. Even Hot Rod gives off this weird, like, off line where he says, like, I just feel it in my circuits that maybe this is really important. There's something about it. I just can't put my.
It's just a shame
on.
That the Decepticons happened to attack right after he said that. Because otherwise, if I was Cuphead, I'd be like, "Go on." No, I want to know. Tell me. You know, it's I don't know, good versus evil, pure of heart. We don't have hearts.
Yeah. Oh, I also love how Starscream just kicks Megatron as soon as he's down. It's just like. I knew Starscream was an asshole,
one thing I noticed about this movie, like, yeah, there is some fan service if you were a fan, you know, unless your favorite character killed off, but if you were a Starscream fan, he has a lot of time to shine in this movie. Like, I'm curious if, Mike, if you got the sense of who Starscream was.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, right away.
He's like second banana to Megatron.
He's jealous, but also he's a slimy, you know, little prick. Like, he's
a little bastard.
Yeah.
And then he throws... throws Megatron off the ship.
Megatron is dying.
And then he wants to have this car. I mean, like, well, then he. What is the big
Cybertron?
Asshole? The big asshole.
Unicron.
Unicron catches him and says, "You gotta get the thing for me."
Yeah, and Megatron is like floating into space, and then Unicron like captures him
and makes apparently it, and much, like the distance between. Earth and Cybertron and Unicron, it's like, I guess it's like driving down the street to go grocery shopping.
Yeah, so, yeah. You know, there's immediate, like, just make a left turn on this planet.
If I could be super geek, the Transformers series had introduced something called the Space Bridge, which was like they were able to warp to, you know, certain places quicker. Right. So maybe we could just say that's what they were using. But I don't think so.
Sure, that's fine.
No, it was kind of like a nice juxtaposition because you see the death of the leader of the good guys and everyone's devastated. It's very solemn. And then
there actually is a nice separation of like who the good and evil are. It's like the good version. It's just like, oh my god, this is devastating. Mm-hmm. I mean, we just lost our leader. And then with the Decepticons, like, nah, I'm going to be the leader. And Starscream just, like, pushes their leader outside and just... And Megatron is all like, no, I still am okay.
I'm still functional.
Which really doesn't make no sense because the Decepticons could fly, and I guess they could fly through space.
Well, he was
and they
weak.
Don't have to breathe.
Yeah, he was weak.
He was floating around, and then he gets taken in the tractor beam and has to not even make a deal, kind of against his will.
Yeah.
To get that, what is that thing called? The Matrix.
The Matrix.
Yeah, and Megatron is basically like saying, "No, I'm gonna control my destiny." But Unicron's just like, "No, you're my slave. Here's your new suit, which is Here's the new Megatron.
Here's new toys.
He's now Galvatron, and they introduce. And here are your band of misfits. This guy.
I'm curious. Well, I don't know because
Galvatron, who that honestly, there's
who turns into the choo choo.
Astro.
Oh, that's Astro.
I like the purple choo choo.
He looks like Thomas the Tank Engine.
I love that there's a character named Astro Train.
And they're all inside him.
Who turns into, well, he's a triple changer. He turns into a space shuttle and a train. Don't ask.
Yeah.
That somehow he changes in size and he could, like, house the other giant robots. But a robot that turns into a train named Astro Train, that's like my birth name being Big Cartoonist.
Yeah.
You're gonna be a train. I want to be a race car driver. No, you're gonna be a train.
No, you were designed to be a gun. You're gonna shrink in size somehow.
Oh, that's another thing about this is that Megatron turns into a gun, and he's held by Starscream. Probably, you know,
the guy who wants to kill him,
and it's just, whatever. It's one of those.
I remember on forums there used to be people. There would be a thread. Someone's like, I don't get it. Starscream fires Megatron in his gun form, but Starscream wants to take over the Decepticons. Why doesn't he just kill Megatron when he turns into a gun? And someone's like, well, the Thundercracker and Skywarp would probably interfere soon after and shoot him. I'm like, stop making logic. You know? But that's
it's a cartoon.
But he
reformats Megatron, Galvatron, gives him a new voice, Leonard Nimoy.
Yeah, Leonard gives Nimoy. Now he's...
I'm curious if you guys caught the major animation error in this scene. Three robots get turned to Scourge and his two huntsmen, the Sweeps, and then there's Cyclonus, the warrior, and his armada, which is, I guess, another copy of Cyclonus.
Mm-hmm.
Right after that scene, you never see two Cyclonuses ever again. It's just one Cyclonus, and then Scourge, and three Sweeps.
One got lost.
Yep.
On the way back.
One just turned like, I like the guys with the mustache more. I'm going to look like him.
That is such a nerd observation. For someone like me, I would never really guess that, but it's like... It's
maybe not in your first viewing.
No, but yeah.
I love Starscream's coronation.
Yeah,
it's hilarious. And he just gets turned into ash.
Yeah,
that's in. Like,
and he gets a crown. That crown to me is like the most memorable thing because I always remember people like saying like, "Oh, they're gonna make a toy of the crown," and I'm just like, "What the fuck?"
Where do they get all their organic material to make a giant robot cape?
You gotta give this movie a lot of credit.
Someone is knitting a tiny with tiny little needles to make a giant.
Someone transformed cape. Into needles and like or a sewing machine. There's a transformer that's a sewing machine.
you gotta admit this. First of all, them having, you know, the chutzpah to kill off all these characters. Mm-hmm. Like, you knew it was a done deal. Like, you remember the original characters? You know how you liked the first two seasons? Well, even Starscream, the villain that you actually like.
Oh, yeah.
Starscream dies. Too. Like, yeah. That's the thing. Like, Starscream is probably the one constant in that series because he's the only character that actually has some ambition and goals. And once he dies, like, what's the point? You know, it's like there's no one.
Starscream is dead.
But you have to admit, though, them having the chutzpah to kill off these characters, they do it in grand fashion. It's not just, you know, just shot in the camera.
They give them their moments.
They have these incredibly.
I mean, robots just get killed left and right in so many imaginative ways. Mm. Eaten by shark robots, melted down and like digested.
Oh,
goo.
Yeah.
Blasted in the stomach.
Sounds like a Spike TV
almost
series.
Eaten by a robot kraken.
Yeah, pulled apart, blown apart.
Oh yeah,
step heads crushed under a door.
So anyway, so now we have Galvatron, who is basically Megatron 2.0.
Yes,
and now he's going to attack the Autobots again.
Well, he kills Starscream, of course.
He kills Starscream because, like, fuck you, Starscream. You threw me out of a fucking spaceship, asshole. and deservedly so.
That's so Starscream.
But, I know. That's our Starscream. Yeah. So, but then they go back to Earth and they start firing at the Autobots again. And this time it's like, well, they have to escape. And there's, like, that big scene where they're taking their two ships off. And this is basically where it's like they split up.
Yes.
So it's like they're off. This is the part in the movie where it's like now we're delving into new territory. This is like like part B of the plot.
Yeah, we knew was Cybertron and Earth.
Yeah. So they take these two ships, they split apart, and they're on two different planets, which are mechanical based. I mean, they're both, like, they're robots' planets.
Yeah.
So they're not Cybertron. They're just kind of, like, these other off-planets.
Which could be underwater planet with metal sand.
Yeah, which has, like, a weird judicial system of this five-faced core being.
Well, I always thought, like, or just, like, other alien planets mechanical, too, just because it's Transformers, and hey, why not? Like, people
yeah,
like
no,
robots,
it's like,
or is it because, then, you know, these characters could get ripped apart, bashed, and all that, because they're robots, and we could get away with this.
I just find it funny, this is the filler part of this movie, where it's just like, okay, we need some time to kill, and we can't just have it to be fighting, you know, the Autobots or the Decepticons.
Yeah, this is when I kind of actually mentally check out of this movie a little bit.
Yeah,
this is like that's probably when the movie slows down, despite it being
action all the way through.
Yeah.
And there's this one part where it's like Cup, who is the old gold
yeah
guy, this
Autobot stories.
Does this remind you of anything? I can't remember a thing. This reminds me of that story. Oh, we need to also talk about the fact that Cup is basically the storyteller to the Dinobots, which are...
It's pretty much just Yoshi from Super Mario World. Yeah, split into three separate dinosaurs.
Yeah.
Four.
Four. I forgot there was a fourth dinosaur.
I would say it's mostly Grimlock. It's just mostly the Tyrannosaurus.
You want to know another great thing? Despite this movie looking really good for its time, it's riddled with so many animation errors, as the TV series
was. Oh, yeah. No,
there's four Dinobots in this movie. There's five Dinobots. One of them is a Stegosaurus called Snarl, who is in this movie in about three scenes, but they forgot the character existed, so he's pretty much not in the movie.
All I remember was, like, in the cockpit, it's just the Pterodactyl, the Brontosaurus, and Grimlock.
And there was a Triceratops.
Oh, there was a Triceratops. I mean, that's what I meant. A Triceratops.
But then there's, like, you were saying...
Snarl.
But then there's also a long-necked dinosaur.
Yeah. The
there's six dinosaurs.
No, there's Grimlock, who's the T-Rex. Swag, who is the Triceratops. The Pterodactyl, which is Swoop. And, bear with me, guys. And and Sludge, who is the Brontosaurus.
I know that there's five of them, but it's like... Yeah, in every scene, you only see four of them.
Yeah. Well, there's a few scenes. I think there's like three scenes where Snarl is there.
But it gets to the point where it's just like these are just they're side concepts. You know, it's like they're just like kind of pushed aside, and then they show up every once in a while where it's like it gets to the point where it's like, my God, there's so many characters in this.
Yeah,
and
why they gotta kill them.
You start. Yeah, we gotta kill them
for new ones.
No, we need the like. Lower the character.
And no one kills the child.
Well, as a Transformer fan...
The child is bulletproof.
Just your average Transformer fan would probably just talk about, why did they forget to include Snarl? Why do they keep using character models of Thundercracker and Skywarp, even though we saw them die and change into new robots? Now working in animation, I realize, there's someone in charge of designing all these characters, and then it's the board artists.
Mm-hmm.
They just take these characters and use them. So they're thinking, well, here's the characters I have to work with. Oh, here's a crowd shot of all the Decepticons.
That's true.
Let me draw all the Decepticons we have. Not knowing that no one probably tells them, don't use them anymore.
The fact that there's like 30 fucking characters in this movie, and they all have like, not a decent amount of screen time, but enough screen time where it's like, oh, I gotta remember
plenty
this
of them
guy
deceased.
And this guy, and many of them die, and then they kind of come back.
Well,
you
kind of bring up a good point, Steve, because it's like when you're in, especially on a TV show, you're given a pack of characters that are just used for the background. Like these are background characters, and they're recognizable characters because you'll use them quite often.
Mm-hmm.
So. I would assume in the show sometimes it would just be like, okay, I'm going to use these couple characters for this scene because they're filler in for the characters that we're trying to focus on. So
they used to just repaint Starscream all the time.
Yeah.
They just do like, oh, here's a neon green Starscream.
I mean, I can't imagine like for the Ninja Turtles. I mean, you have four characters that pretty much look the same, but they have different weapons and different colored bandanas. And that's pretty much all you can do to decipher who is who. So,
but at least it's four turtles and not like 30 fucking turtles.
Right. Yeah.
And then April and Shredder and Splinter.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like you got two humans, a couple dinosaurs, and a bunch of fucking robots that all kind of have the same proportions and shape.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, yeah. And some bug robots.
And bug robots. And one really feminine, curvy robot. And Eric Idle robot with a fucking Fu Manchu.
We're not at that point yet. But
it all blends together to me in the middle of the movie.
We're up to the giant squid.
He fights a giant squid.
Yes, a giant robot squid.
Yeah, Cup is... basically dismembered at this point, but he's easily put back together by Hot Rod.
Mm-hmm. And all you do is just it.
And here's something funny that we noticed: like when they're underwater, the animation acts as if all of the metal, all the metal base of the underwater is supposed to be sand, but it's like it's just metal.
It's metal and chrome, like flat ground.
So at some point they probably thought like, oh, so there's going to be sand on this planet. And it's like a beach. They're underwater. Nope, that's metal.
Gotta love that 1080p Blu-ray quality. because I've never noticed that
before. Yeah, and there's also a lot of moments where we notice the
edge of the cell.
The edge of the cell has disappeared. So or the end of where they decided not to paint anymore.
Yeah. That's like, remember we saw one of the cuts of, what was it, Troll in Central Park?
Yeah.
And there's a whole scene where the characters are only like a third of the way into the screen and yeah. they just disappear in pieces.
Yeah. Yeah, that's hilarious. And it just becomes a foot, like a floating yeah. foot before it disappears.
But this is where we get to the part of the movie where it's like, oh, let's just come up with some new scenarios for these characters. We have pretty much the Quintesson planet, which is... They don't do a clear enough job explaining this, but these are the underlings of Unicron. And I guess they just hang around and it's like, oh, have you met Unicron before? Oh, well, you're guilty of not getting killed
by
Unicron.
So wait, they're connected to Unicron in some way? Like that floating head thing.
Yeah,
that,
the
like,
judge. Where that, it's
really?
Many, yeah.
There was absolutely no indication that they were connected to Unicron.
It's a throwaway line.
Huh. Then I must have missed it, because it's like...
Actually, I could be... No, you know what? I'm sorry. I'm wrong. Mm. I am wrong, because Kranix, the guy who escapes in the beginning of the movie, is like, oh, these are the Quintesson, the Sharktacons, and the Cruel Masters of the Quintessons. My planet was destroyed by Unicron. Like, he didn't take a break. It's just dropping all these names.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And Cup and Hot Rod are just like everyone else, and they're like, who,
yeah,
what?
Who's, they, what? They, all
who's
they,
Unicron?
All I remember is them asking, like, who's Unicron? It's like, he's a thing that destroyed my planet. No, I'm the last one! I'm Kal-El! I'm supposed to be the Superman!
Yeah, my mistake. The Quintessons are just a weird backwards planet, and...
Yeah.
Oh god, I don't want to get into the canon that they created for them in the cartoon.
That'll be for another day.
That's a can of robot worms. I don't want to, because there probably are robot.
But
worms.
Yeah, they're
probably
they're,
hot rod fishes with robot worms.
Yeah, so. but they're being sentenced in this weird. I mean, Cup and Hot Rod are being sentenced in this weird judicial system.
If you're innocent, you're thrown to the
shark
robot.
It's opposite planet.
Yeah, yeah. It's the what is it? The Bizarro.
Yeah. Up means down. Down means up.
Topsy turvy. Everything is upside down.
And then there's like a robot with tentacles that just constantly. I guess he's like the lawyer or something. He's like, what do? You, how do you find these defendants? And then he's like, they're innocent.
Spare me this mockery of justice.
Innocent. And then they drop into like a pool of piranha robots.
In urine.
In yeah. Robot urine. Urine
water.
Melted
so,
butter.
But I mean, Hot Rod and Cup, eventually they fight their way out of this. And then the dinosaurs come.
Oh, yeah. Because with the help of a new friend. And this makes.
Oh, I hate this character.
Tiny, unintelligible pink thing.
Wheelie.
What's this character?
Wheelie.
Wheelie?
Like Papa Wheelie.
That's Wheelie?
That's Wheelie.
What the fuck? Okay, for the longest time, I was just like, who is this little shit? I've never seen this before.
It's really confusing because he's just thrown... He just happens to be on this planet and he talks in like rhymes.
It's
like,
Wheelie confusing.
Shut up.
Yeah,
he talks in rhymes and he's very high-pitched and I...
Voiced by Frank Welker.
Yeah.
But... Here, it's so weird because he apparently is an Autobot, but no one knows who he is.
Yeah, that was funny because, like, the first time I saw him, I was just like, oh, he's an Autobot because he has that icon on
Wheelie
his chest.
Wheelie really kind of represents the change in what they came up with characters after this movie for season 3 because when you think about it, like, Transformers is something completely different than what, you know, people that watch cartoons in the West, remember, because they grew up on Looney Tunes and Hanna-Barbera and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. So there's still, like, this cartoon mindset.
Yeah.
So instead of coming up with, like, you know, like, Cup, like Cup is an interesting enough character. It's like, oh, he's a grizzled war vet. And then you have Blur. He talks really fast. And then there's Wheelie. He talks in rhymes. And Retgar. He talks like he's an infomercial. It's like, what the... It's very...
He talks like a laser. That's what he's...
It's very Hanna-Barbera.
Which is funny, too, because talking about the sound effects, like, in the beginning, there's, like, that crunching noise. Like
yeah, where the planet is eating another planet.
The planet is eating a planet.
And it's just like a Hanna-Barbera chewing, gomping
which
sound
kind of
effect.
Like... Now, honestly, it's like you notice that, and it's very obviously a cartoon sound effect.
I was waiting for one of them to just go yipe and just like do like that little scramble foot coconut sound that Fred Flintstone makes when he's about to run
away.
The
laser noises are that usual like that weird thump sound.
Oh,
from
thwomp! God, if only when Prowl was shot, he just let out like a tomcat scream.
Leather lung scream.
Mm-hmm. So
shark anyway, bots.
Where are we? Okay, the shark.
Dinosaurs convince the shark robots to go after the five-faced floating robot. So
there's less of them, and they don't seem to fight much. Yeah. The shark cons are like, sure. That's how you do a mutiny. Just real quick. It's like, fight them instead.
Yeah, like, so but they basically, they find like a ship that is a corkscrew.
Yeah.
A corkscrew ship that just like kind of spins around.
It looks like one of those, you ever see like the videos on YouTube where they pour molten mercury down an anthill and then they dig it out and then it's just this beautiful designed metal thing. It just looks like a Dolly-esque anthill.
Something so cruel and horrid makes something so beautiful.
Yeah. And yeah, so they find this giant corkscrew, but they go, they're on the junk planet. And
oh yeah. Meanwhile, on this other planet,
this is where Ultra Magnus, who's the current leader of the Autobots, he has the Matrix.
Yeah,
and he gets fucking.
Well, the Decepticons track them down, and he gets it worse than Optimus Prime.
He explodes. He fucking explodes into bits and pieces.
I really enjoyed seeing your reactions to that because it was.
I was just laughing at Andrew.
Was originally.
Well, here's the thing. When he blew up, I was just like, oh, they destroyed another character. And then, like, later on, it's like they meet the Junkions or something. Yeah. Retgar. Voiced by Eric Idle, who makes my head pound.
I still can't understand
every
what
time
he's
he says a word because it was like bam 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 bam. It's this weird like
news at 11. It's this, hurry.
Yeah, and it's this weird like laser pulse noise every time he says something.
Uh huh.
So it's like it's like pronouncing your B's. You know, the biscuits are
bought the bracelet for Belinda's birthday.
Yeah, it's,
the Autobots.
But if that was like a piercing laser into your jaw, you know, it's like it's. Ooh. It's like,
we've all had root
canals. Ow, that really hurts. Please stop talking, Eric. But later on, it's like there's that Mad Max scene where it's Dare to Be Stupid. They're being chased by, which is a really fun scene. They're being chased by, but then...
Because they look like they're post-apocalyptic looking robots.
Yeah,
like, they
look on a junk gang. Planet, yeah. which are just, you know, they're a gang of motorcyclists. They're a biker gang. They're after things because they don't understand it. So, but then Hot Rod comes to the planet and he's with Cup and the Dinobots and they give off. They were saying like the universal greeting, which is what was it?
Ba weep grana weep ninny bomb.
And immediately I was thinking like Una egg nut shall one nay off. Well, then Hanna-Barbera
cartoon. And probably the most the biggest moment of secondhand embarrassment in this movie comes when they're just it just cuts into this big dance number.
Oh yeah, yeah. It turns into an Ewok dance. It's like the Ewok celebrates And so here's the part that got to me. They put Ultra Magnus back together. And it's just normal. It's just like here's your buddy. Here's your buddy back. And
Optimus Prime got just like shot in the belly.
Yeah. So Optimus Prime gets shot in the fucking stomach and they say that his wounds are too fatal. He can't make it. And I can forgive the scene where Hot Rod puts Cup back together because his arm and leg is
somewhere.
It's
like an arm and a leg.
Yeah, it's an arm and a leg. Okay, I can understand that. He puts that back together. It's like, I feel good. I can feel like I can punch a Decepticon already. So and then there's a scene where Ultra Magnus is in just tiny little pieces. And
Retgar.
He explodes. Retgar and the Junkions just put him back together. He's fine and back to normal. They just shine him up. He's fine.
They even polish him.
And I'm like, they polish him. And I'm just like, what? What?
Take them back to Earth and do this to Prime right now. Yes. We need him.
What do they do with Prime?
Recycle him? Where is he buried?
Well, actually, they...
They just dropped him in the ocean.
I know what they do, but I don't need to say. No.
Did they eat him?
Robots need food. No, it's funny because with the whole we talk about, like, I feel like the theme of this movie has been robot deaths.
Yeah,
Magnus was supposed to get it a lot worse than he did. Like, apparently they were supposed to like rip off his limbs one by one, just brutally murder. Like, what is wrong wrong with these people?
Wow.
I honestly think...
It's called having your cake and eating it too.
I just think...
We can't do it to a real person, so yeah. If we could do it to a robot, it's okay.
Yeah, I think a lot of these producers are full of shit. And they say, oh, we didn't know people react like this. Like,
here's the thing, we can't smoke cigarettes
in like the 80s, like, oh, want to be awesome if his arm gets ripped off and then he's beaten with it.
Well, here's the thing about that is that when you're on a show and you're talking to S&P, Standards and Practices, mm-hmm. it's like, okay, so we have like a group of things that can just be demolished, whatever, for these main characters. Like for the Ninja Turtles, it was the foot soldiers. We can't have them be human characters. But if they're robots, we can see them get cut up. We can see them, like, you know, lop off their head and like throw it because, you know, we established that they're robots. They're not real. Mm. They're not real human beings that can have blood and stuff like that. That's why Samurai Jack, everything that Samurai Jack slices open is a robot.
Yeah.
Even if it's like an organic looking thing, if they slice it open, it has to have robot parts inside.
And it's got a spark and then blow up.
Yeah. It's and then that, oil everywhere. That basically, yeah. That would basically be fine for that. So I would assume that it's just like, oh, well, you're just going to have us like be able to kill robots all we want? We're going to make it as disturbing as possible. So. I can assume like they had plans to just kind of like torture the fuck out of Ultra Magnus. Just be like, no, give me your face, and you know, it's just like
the robot skin and just the skull.
I mean, think of the death of with Chef the piranhas. It's like with the piranhas, there's a moment where the Dinobot like punches one in the face, and his like entire mouth just shatters.
Yeah.
And then there's another one where it just like slices the other one in the face. Like, oh geez, sorry,
breaks
Frank.
It down to just like a little robot skeleton.
Yeah, yeah. So
they took full advantage of it.
I would think it's like, it's taking our cake and eating it. It's basically just like, oh, you're not going to let us do this. Well, we're going to do this.
Yeah.
So, and it's like, well, you didn't say that we couldn't do it. So there you go.
It's creative friction.
Yeah.
You're given an obstacle and you find a very creative way to get around it.
Yeah. Which makes things ultimately, I would think that it would make things a lot more creative because it makes you think outside of the box. It's
how
like,
many ways can you kill a robot? Melting them.
Sounds like a YouTube series.
Yeah. But either way, that entire scene just made me go like
you
I was just
lost
like
lost it.
Right.
Yeah, I really was just like, okay, so if you're going to kill off a very memorable character like Optimus Prime and have that in like wonderful scene where all the other robots are just like, oh my god, Optimus is dead, what are we gonna do now? And then you have another scene where another robot gets just blown to smithereens. We've just seen tons of robots die.
Mm-hmm. Robot guts.
And then all of a sudden, he's put back together. He's fine. He's still part of the cast.
Ultra Magnus will return.
By the way, I lost the matrix of the thing. Oh, yeah, Ultra Magnus, the voice of the guy from Unsolved Mysteries.
Robert Stack. Because I remember my mom used
every
to watch
time we
Unsolved
hear him.
Mysteries. That used to be on, like, Lifetime Channel. And my mom used to watch Unsolved Mysteries, and Robert Stack used to be the host.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember that Unsolved Mysteries.
If you've seen this person,
please and call that, the Unsolved
the only other
Mysteries.
Thing I can think of is Airplane,
you
right?
Squeal.
What?
He's in the first Airplane. Or is it?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Like those are the.
I think he's in both Airplanes. Actually,
probably. Yeah, those are the two things.
He's a recognizable voice, and he's a very well-known actor as well. So, and the funny thing about things like Airplane and that is that they chose to give these hilarious roles to very serious actors, because that it helps. It helps the joke.
Mm-hmm.
So if you give like very serious actors and give them really funny things to do and say, it makes the joke even funnier.
And then you have someone like, let's have Scatman Crothers play a robot called Jazz.
Which is, you know,
a funny
I mean,
story about Scatman, because, you know, like these guys actually watch the show. But one time he came in a recording session, he just, of course, he's the only, African-American voice actor on there. He's like, oh, can someone tell me what my robot looks like? Like, does it look different from all your other robots? Like, no, it pretty much looks the same thing. It's like, you got, you you gotta be kidding me. I voice a robot that looks exactly the same as all you other guys. It's hilarious. Watching, I watched like a DVD bonus feature of just all the voice actors. And all like older voice actors. Like guys that were doing stuff like in the 70s and the 80s. It's just a bunch of old men just getting together. It's like they're playing
poker. It
was
a bunch of old guys like in charge of the show. Yeah. I mean, it was... it's really funny to know that these shows were run by people who were just, they wanted to make a cartoon, and they this was how they could do it.
They also wanted to make money.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. They wanted to make money. It's a job.
Lots and lots of money.
It's a job. It is. You know, so.
But it's just, it's kind of weird what, like, people will have will be sentiment towards, you know, all these years later.
It's, there's something admirable about it. I can honestly, I mean, I digress.
We wouldn't be talking about this.
We honestly, I mean, we wouldn't still be talking about it, and we still wouldn't be having toys and, it's not and like, shows it's
not
about
like,
it.
You know, it's not like the Care Bears has this kind of power.
I mean, there is an audience for everything.
Not like this.
Not like this.
But,
Where are we?
Lionheart didn't die in the first act of the second Care Bears movie.
And they take his heart out of his chest. And Lionheart. God. Oh my God, he actually has a lion for a heart.
Imagine like the Care Bears movie if it was like that. Okay, we need to make an entire new set of characters. And let's kill off the other Care Bears.
Is it all what they did in those movies? Is they just introduced new characters that were never like?
Well, I do know that in terms of the Care Bears, the Care Bear cousins were introduced in one of the movies.
Are we really talking about Care Bears?
Yeah, we are.
Because when you break this down, it's freaking toys.
Then there's fucking flying ponies and horn ponies and
but then they go to regular ponies.
Listen,
they gotta get their sparkle points. They don't get their horn.
You have to give these shows some credit because toys are they make a big impact to kids.
Because not everything like lasts like people remember Street Sharks for its lore, you know.
But lore, they're fucking land sharks.
I love talking about Street Sharks because every time Street Sharks comes up, I keep thinking about how horrible those characters have it.
Yeah,
and they're just like. Oh my God!
But there's stuff like that. There's stuff like whatever that toy line was with the dinosaurs and people rode them and shot lasers.
Oh yeah!
And there's stuff like the Transformers where, holy crap, they're still making Transformers stuff.
Yeah.
There's like the comics for the older audience. There's like the new TV cartoons.
I have the comics. I read them every once in a while.
Michael Bay movies where people don't realize you know, what a good movie is. You know?
Yeah.
Oh, so. Now,
what planet are we on now?
At this point, we're on the planet of Junk. You know, Ultra Magnus.
Oh yeah, but they go to Cybertron because after Ultra Magnus,
well, Galvatron took the Matrix, and like, oh, where is he? And for some reason, Wreck-Gar knows that he went to go see Unicron. So I'm like, oh, we got to destroy Unicron. So
because we saw it on TV.
They know where Unicron is, but they
because they saw it on TV.
Yeah, so and then it's Unicron swallows up Galvatron.
Well,
Galvatron
he transforms.
He basically thinks
needlessly transforms from a fucking giant ball asshole that can actually destroy planets
to just an asshole.
To just an asshole.
To
just a giant robot.
Yeah,
and it's like when
basically Orson Welles is a robot.
If it ain't
Dracula.
Broke, don't fix it.
But tell me this. Tell me that's not an amazing sequence of animation.
It is.
Oh, it's amazing.
It is fun.
Like
you talk about all those. You were wowed just by that first instance of you know Unicron in planet form, just going by the screen and perspective.
Yeah. But the thing is, like if you're a giant planet that eats other planets and you haven't lost. I mean, like they blew up a ship in his mouth and it didn't even leave a scratch.
Yeah.
If it ain't broke, don't fix it. Like, I'm going to destroy this planet. I could just eat this planet like any other fucking planet. Instead, I'm going to transform into a needlessly giant robot.
It's kind of vulnerable.
It makes him more vulnerable, and he's just punching the planet now?
Yeah.
If only someone told Unicron that, and he'd still be
right. Like, what made him say, like, you know what? I think for this time around, I'm gonna not be a giant asshole.
Well, as I was watching it, I thought...
But I'm gonna be a giant asshole. Yeah. And destroy your planet.
Well, when I was watching it, I was basically, like, in my mind, I was kind of, like, trying to figure out the logistics of this. For me, it was like...
Don't you hurt your head.
No, yeah. I know. But I mean, like, for me, it seemed like Unicron... Cybertron is too big for even Unicron. So it's like, Cybertron is, like, bigger than Unicron. So like, it's like, well, I gotta break this down.
Yeah.
You know, so,
that's
so,
how I interpret it.
I'm gonna be so fucking constipated.
And he was still really fucking up the planet. I mean, he was like, I guess baby robots and children robots.
You
robot. Want
to know some shit though?
Yeah.
And this has become a part of the Transformers lore later, but this was the part of the original idea for this movie is Cybertron is also a giant robot planet. Like, yeah. I mean, it's a planet that is the home to giant robots. But it is, it's just like Unicron, it is a planet that turns into a giant robot, because I think it's this weird religion thing where there was the first 12 Transformers, and two of them are Unicron and Cybertron, which is known as Primus, and pretty much it's like it's God all, and Satan.
It's all in that arc, it's all in that arc thing that I have. That's,
so maybe you could chalk it down, it's like, oh, maybe Unicron can't get Cybertron.
But he does swallow Galvatron.
Just...
Oh yeah, he picks him off of his shoulder,
robot boar,
like a little fly, and just like kind of like swallows him, like just down the gullet,
and then he's in there, and then
down the hatch, Galvatron.
We should mention at this point that I don't think we ever mentioned that Galvatron was like, oh, I hate being controlled by this dude. I'm gonna take the Matrix and try to.
Oh
use this
yeah,
to
yeah.
Him. We kind of just
Unicron,
you
like
dummy.
I guess kind of like controls him.
Yes,
but also Galvatron is like I still want to keep calling him Megatron, because it's like. I know he's Megatron.
Yeah.
So he basically
he'll always be Megatron.
He'll always be Megatron in my heart. He thinks that this Matrix is going to like control Unicron or something. He thinks it's like, ah, now I have it. But he's still kind of like controlled by Unicron.
How do I do this?
Yeah, he's like he's trying to like use it like a Rubik's cube. It's like,
yeah.
Just eat that damn orange.
But yeah, and then. But so they started the Autobots start attacking, and then they somehow break into inside of Hot Rod gets inside of well they all get inside because
they ride the giant screw right through his eye.
Yeah, they go in through the eye, and apparently other Autobots and Spike are alive, and they're going to be digested in this giant vat
with a lid.
And we see
why would he have a lid? For the sake of closing it so he could save the day?
Well, you know, just in case he gets like
takes up a lot of energon, man. Sometimes you gotta preserve that goo.
Well,
my goo. You can't let it dry up, you gotta put a cover on it.
Yep. Well, you know, when he has acid reflux, it's just like you gotta close that.
Just the souls and screams of many robots.
Yeah, you thought like
there's even a moment where he's like holding his stomach and there's like an audible like
gurgle.
It's like, oh, I have a stomach ache.
Oh, too many robots.
Bye. Just I want to. I wish.
I ate a Decepticon that didn't. Agree
I wish
with
Orson
me.
Welles just went, "Oh my tummy."
I wish they just recorded him like when he was recording, like, oh, "I ate too much today." Like, we're using that. No, if you thought the gruesome robot deaths were
there's
over,
there's a French fry in my beard.
There's a Megatron cube stuck in my beard. If you thought the gruesome deaths were over, luckily these were just random
incidental
characters.
Women and children robots.
Well, actually, one of the characters that falls right before Skype is actually a Skype. I'm sorry, not the program. Spike. One of the characters that falls right before him is a named character that you don't see fall in, and you don't see him ever again. So, like, did he die? And of course, there's probably a million YouTube videos now, probably at this point, talking about did Beachcomber actually
they all
die?
Had names.
Let's talk about
they
it.
All they but all had lives
they
at one
die
point.
In this
Steve.
Goo. You gotta think of how elaborate, like, one thing that blows my mind with this movie is just all the functions that are going on here. Like, there's a bunch of hooks on these. Vines
yeah, there's
are
very like
after
you
them.
Know like the thing sort of where it's like these tentacles that start clamping on a thing.
Unicron is truly a big playset.
Yeah,
it's like here's the goop where you could drop in your Transformers to melt and die. Here's the crazy cranes that chase after him. Here's the river. You know, it's like Unicron is a big playset.
Yeah,
and
he is.
Like, I mean, they didn't necessarily make a toy like that, but you got to admire. Like all the thought that went into it.
Yeah, but anyway,
Unicron is Discovery Zone.
The kid,
it's just a big
oh
Discovery
my God.
Zone.
No wonder why I love him.
Well, anyway, the kid in his exosuit.
Help me, Daniel! I'm gonna fall into the ball pit. It's gross. Someone pee.
Ew! My hair is caught in the roller slide. Every time I go to a Discovery Zone, there'd always be a girl going, ow, ow, ow. And then there would be a person who works there who's like, all right, give me a minute. And then they have to, like, get the hair out.
I want to see Jazz playing the alligator game. It's like, man, this is rigged.
Wait a minute. Shit.
Jazz, you've been alive this whole time and just playing games? Yeah. It's fine.
Try the pizza. It's edible.
There's like an entire like Chuck E. Cheese like stage inside of Unicron singing a song like, you're gonna get digested, you're gonna be
Soundwave is in there, he's like, he provides the music.
Oh my god.
You're gonna be digested.
Happy birthday, Timmy. Happy 8th birthday. Here is lukewarm pizza and
you're the birthday, you're the birthday, you're the birthday, boy or girl.
How old are you? Actually, that's great. Let's sing a song.
Oh, don't get me on the Simpsons tangent.
All right, let's go.
Yeah, well, we're kind of wrapping this up now. Yeah. There's a big battle inside Unicron.
Between Galvatron and Hot Rod,
who basically ends up becoming the new leader.
Because he's able to grab the Matrix from him, and it... This is because the whole time, the Matrix is supposed to, there's a prophecy. It's supposed to, an Autobot will rise from our ranks and use the power of the Matrix to light our darkest hour.
Which Optimus didn't even know. He was just like, here,
yeah, I heard this. And Magnus was like, this is the moment, right? This is pretty dark, right? This is some gruesome shit. And
I love that. I obviously love that moment. I was like, this is it, right? It's really dark. I'm going to die.
Well,
right?
Speaking of seeing Ultra Magnus and me just saying shit. There's two curse words in this movie.
Oh, yeah. There's like,
shit. And you're like, and then every boy in the audience is like, oh, I love this movie.
Can I say that now, Mom?
Yeah. Like, me being a super teenager, when I would, like, watch, you know, like, bootleg copies of Dragon Ball Z, and there would be curse words. I'm like, oh, they curse in cartoons.
I got, like...
The stuff I like is mature.
When I was a kid, I literally freaked out when in The Secret of Nim, one of the
when he goes, damn.
Yeah,
I was gonna say, like, and they almost lost. I think they lost their G rating because of that damn.
Because of that one damn.
Yeah.
Wow, I'm surprised with Nim. That's fine. But they wanted a PG rating for this movie. They wanted to push some things just so it didn't seem so much
PG?
Like a kiddie movie.
Yeah.
It's PG.
It's PG.
Yeah.
Oh, come on, man. Robot deaths.
But yeah, so he gets the Matrix. He becomes
He opens it
robot
up.
Jesus.
Rodimus Prime.
Yeah, he becomes Rodimus Prime.
Rodimus Prime. What do you think of that name, Mike?
Rodimus?
Rodimus.
It sounds like a basketball player. Rodimus Prime. Three-pointer. Rodimus Prime.
It kind of sounds like a sex toy to me.
Oh, yeah.
Try my Rodimus Prime. It's filled with the Matrix.
I've never been.
Bop it.
It vibrates.
Bop it. Twist it. Pull it.
It's a ridiculous name, but unfortunately, like, Hasbro doesn't necessarily have the rights to the name Hot Rod because it's such a generic term.
Oh yeah. That's...
So he's in all the other stuff that he's used.
Who the hell
in.
Owns it? Big Daddy Roth? Like, who owns it?
Probably.
He's referred to as Rodimus. So, I mean, it makes sense if you know the backstory.
Big Dadimus,
like, what the hell's a Rodimus? I don't know what part of my car
Ignatius,
that is.
Rodimus, Thaddeus.
Well, what's what is Ultra Magnus?
What's a Magnus?
Yeah, I mean, maybe they couldn't... His real name was Magnet? Ultra Magnet?
He's an Asterix character. He's one of the Romans. Magnum Opus.
Magnanimous. Well, anyway, he opens this up. It begins to destroy the insides of Unicron.
He throws Galvatron out of Unicron's ass, which I think is made out of paper mache.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, he gets launched through that wall. And then he pretty much...
They go out of his other eye.
Yeah. And I love how he pretty much releasing the Matrix was like putting... It was like the Mentos and Diet Coke. It's everything bursts from the inside out like an Alka-Seltzer. Yeah. Like, it's like a Gus. It's like if you put an Alka-Seltzer and a goose, and it'll blow up because geese can't burp.
Yeah.
It's pretty much that. And they're all like, we got to get out of here. Let's drive out of this robot.
It's an amazing sequence.
Unicron
is freaking the hell out. He's exploding from the inside. And one of his instincts is to just remove his ankle.
Oh, yeah.
Just
Yeah, it's like oh god, itchy, so itchy, itchy. It's like, and he just like removes his leg. It's just like a boot. I gotta take it off. Oh wait, there's nothing underneath. Fuck. And then he explodes. He's just a head.
Goes flying.
His head goes flying off to like
the ending is really in quick.
Orbit of Cybertron.
Right after that blow up, like the movie ends like 45 seconds after that blow up.
We did it.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Rodimus Prime is now the leader, which unbeknownst to
he climbs Pride Rock and roars.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, the thing about this is that Optimus Prime was wrong. You know, it's like he thought Ultra Magnus was going to be like the.
Well, he didn't say like Ultra Magnus. It's like you're the destined one. He just said like
I'm
Ultra
just a
Magnus,
shoulder.
You take over. And yeah. Said, I'm not.
And hold on to this thing.
Yeah, hold
well,
on.
Well, didn't you see the symbolism of when Optimus first dropped the Matrix when he died and Hot Rod picked it up and everything glowed? But then he was like, oh, here. And then Ultra Magnus like. Kid, what the hell are you doing? Give me that. Everything just goes back to normal.
Yeah. Well, either way, things are back to normal. Cybertron is in disarray.
I wouldn't say normal. Just
well, like Cybertron looks like it's just desolated.
Abandoned.
Yeah.
It's robot Swiss cheese right now.
Yeah. It's been stepped on by a giant robot jerk.
We did it. Then you pan out and there's no other robots.
Come on.
And then the head of Unicron basically orbits around Cybertron.
Like a creepy moon that stares at you.
And then we start the credits like Transformers, which is a great song. I will not. It's a great song. Yeah, I do like
it. It gets you amped. They reuse a lot of songs twice, but they use them at the appropriate moments.
I love watching characters die every 3 minutes. That's what I liked about this movie.
All right, so Mike, I'm going to hand this over to you because you have not seen this movie before. I honestly have only seen a little bit of it. I only know bits and pieces of it. From a perspective of someone who has not seen it, not familiar with Transformers, what do you think of this movie?
It's a weird way of saying it. I was confused, but it still made sense. Like, I still understood everything that happened.
Mm-hmm.
There was just a lot of characters, and I'm trying to keep track of who is who. And since I never saw the show, these
but
are all
But almost in
new
a way,
to
it's
me.
Like you don't have to keep track
I almost
of the
have,
characters.
Yeah, I mean, like...
Because they get killed off.
Like, I would...
You just have to focus on the main ones. Like, it's like, oh, those are the main ones that I should focus
on. I'm going
to
be honest. When we were going to do this show, going in, I was like... I'm probably just going to be, and I pretty much did for most of this episode. I just stood back and let you guys talk because I don't know anything about Transformers. I know, like I said, who Optimus Prime and Megatron are.
I'm good at pretending I know about Transformers.
But then, like, yeah, I mean, watching the movie, I understood everything.
Right.
I understood what the motive was. There's a giant fucking robot eating giant planets, and they have to stop it. And there's all this bickering, you know.
You understand the menace.
It was confusing as fuck, and things a lot made little to no sense in many ways. But I still was like, you know, it made as much sense as a fucking Don Bluth movie, storytelling wise.
Yeah,
I could tell.
That's true.
You know, I liked what was the grizzled old
Cup.
I like Cup. You know, I liked how much of a bastard Starscream was.
I liked
the giant asshole. I like the fact that there was a giant
Raise
asshole.
Raise the giant space asshole.
Yeah.
Suck.
But it pretty much was just a giant. And it would just, every once in a while, just boom, just a beam would come out of his ass.
Yeah.
I love it. I thought it was fun.
It's entertaining. Wow.
How does a thing made up of cubes turn into a perfectly spherical ball?
They figured out eventually when they made it to him.
Yeah.
Megatron shrinks into
a gun. I found out, I was talking to some friends, because I'm like, it's pretty amazing seeing how like those robots transform in the new, like, I don't like the new, I've only seen the first Transformers movie, the Michael Bay one.
Yeah, that's the only one.
And then like, they transform, like, that's really neat, like what you could do with the computer. And then I found out most of that's just bullshit.
Yeah.
Like, it's not even like morphing, it's not like they cross-rigged a
it's
truck.
Made to look like it makes sense, but it's really just a
bunch of jumbled shit. It looks pretty much just like static exploding and coming back together.
There's no real logical sense. Like, when you look at like the instruction manuals for most of these Transformers, it's like there's like a way that they make sense in how they transform from one thing to another. But with, like, the Michael Bay movies, it's just like,
I don't know
we need to get from point A to point B.
I don't know how anybody could transform these fucking toys so consistently. I remember getting years ago when I was into Digimon for maybe 4 weeks because everybody else was.
Yeah.
Because that's like with me with everything as a kid. Like Pokemon, I got into because all my friends were into it, but I actually stuck around with it for a while.
Okay.
But then everybody was into Power Rangers, and I had a couple Power Rangers toys, even though I had
I personally was never into Power Rangers.
And same with Transformers. Like I had friends who loved Transformers and shit like that, but yeah. I never really got the toys or watched the shows or anything like that.
Yeah.
But like I had a Digimon toy where one of the Digimon would transform into one of the evolved forms of Digimon. And it was, it's literally a dinosaur changing into another dinosaur with a skull on its face. And I couldn't fucking transform it. Like, it was impossible to remember, all right, do I bend the leg first in and then pull the other one out? Or do I have to do the head first? Like, looking at, you have some Transformers here that actually transform, or you had them.
Yeah.
You still have them?
No, I still have them. They're all in the living room.
Yeah, like,
there's some up there. Like, some of them, like, they're in the living room.
The actual, but the old, the old-fashioned
this
ones.
This is a visual podcast.
That this movie is based on, that toy line. To see someone actually transform that, it's like a Rubik's Cube to me. It confuses the
evolution. It does take, I mean, it really depends. Like, some of them take a little bit too much time as some others.
Yeah, I can't
but
loose parts.
But my opinion of the movie is still, like, I think, from an animation standpoint, I'm just awed by the amount of just work that went into having to animate a fucking box in perspective with multiple facets and arms. I know there's a lot of cheating.
That's something that I really have to give this movie credit for, is that there is a lot of really good
full animation too.
I mean, yeah, there's a lot of good like setup, like there's a lot of good framework. When we were going into this, we were wondering, is this like standard format or is it widescreen when it came out to theaters?
It was full
theaters?
Screen originally.
So I guess it was full screen when it came out to theaters. But then they made a widescreen version.
They probably
just cropped the top and bottom.
They probably cropped top and bottom when they put it in theaters.
Probably.
And it's always been 4:3, and it wasn't widescreen until the 20th anniversary DVD release.
Now the question is, when did the 20th anniversary, that came out 2006?
Yes.
There was a time period in like between 2005 and like 2009 where they would just needlessly crop movies to make them widescreen.
Right.
Like they did
I'm
like
a Dragon Ball Z fan.
Disney did it with Jungle Book and shit.
Yeah.
And that bugged the shit out of me.
Yeah.
And even like with old movies, like they would take movies that were 4:3 and they would have artists design like borders to go around the edge.
I hate that shit.
And it's like, that looks like trash.
It's so distracting.
It is.
First of all, your mind, because you have that frame, especially with an old, if you're watching on a widescreen TV and you have that box, the black of the box goes away.
Yes,
it frames it. You know that it's separating everything outside your television to what's going on in the screen.
Yeah,
and they're doing it like and so like characters, because we have something what we do in boards where they say kissing. When a character, like, there's a tangent formed by the top of a character's head against the top of the frame.
Right.
And we call it kissing because it's like grazing the top. It's not like they're intersected. They're touching it. They're barely touching it. And on those DVDs, because they're cropping the image on the top and the bottom,
it's
to
make cut
it
seem off.
Like, they're cutting them off. Like, people's ankles are cut off in odd places.
Yeah.
People's heads are cut off.
Yeah.
Odd stuff off screen that you're supposed to see doesn't make
It's an easy way out to,
it's bullshit.
Like, bringing him to a modern age.
Now I'm complaining about aspect ratio, but overall, I thought that I enjoyed the movie. I thought it was enjoyable,
and
despite its confusing and almost there's some imagery that almost wants to give you a seizure.
Yeah,
so
it's very
light.
Well done. I honestly admire this movie for the way it looks. It's not perfect, but from what you see and how much detail every frickin' frame has, you have to give some sort of admiration to that. You have to, like, really look at this and say, like, this is not just really a toy movie. I mean, it obviously is, but it still can be something bigger. They obviously had a lot of care and thought into scene works and framework and animation. This was given a ton of effort. So this is, I would have to say, this is a good movie. So, I
Steve laughs.
Because I thought I was gonna have to come up with a different discussion, but you guys are kind of giving a thumbs up. I know you like
Mike, you're never going to watch this movie again.
I mean, I might.
Oh, you like it? Well, I'm going to have to let you borrow the DVDs and stuff, and then like we could.
Oh no, I'm not. I don't care. I don't care that much.
But like, one of the things I was planning on asking you guys was,
I don't care that much.
this movie, when you break it down, it's a marketing scheme. It's a movie to sell toys
based off of
a series meant to sell toys. Why are we talking about it? Yeah. Why are people still talking about it? Why is this so iconic? Why did it get a 30th
anniversary? Why is there a 30th anniversary? Yeah, exactly.
And also...
When there's great movies that have never been on
TV. I don't have anything to compare it to because I've never seen the movie before. I mean, you've probably seen it on old worn-out VHS tapes and stuff.
Not on VHS. My first introduction to it was its original DVD release. I think that was the 2003.
How nice is the picture here in comparison to that?
Oh, it's super clean. Yeah.
Looks great.
Yeah, it looks really nice. I can remember,
because I originally saw this movie in like early 2003.
Yeah, I like the dead bug on the frame. Did you notice that?
Oh, yeah. There was a couple moments where I was like finding little spots in the cell.
I saw what looked like a mill bug. Or a pill bug, and it actually had little legs. Like, it got stuck under the camera, and it's dead, and it's just sliding across the frame.
And for someone that's watched this movie for the first time, for you to just notice that, I'm still distracted by every detail in this movie, that says something.
Well, I mean, I wouldn't have noticed it if it was against the black void of space. When you have a giant white or light-colored flat thing, and then you just see a little black dot go across it like this.
Yeah, moving with the other bigger thing
at the same rate as the thing, because it's on the same cell layer as another ship sliding into frame.
I was like, is that the shadow? No, wait, I think that's a dead bug.
Unreal.
Yeah, but seeing that kind of stuff, it really, I mean, I hate to put it, it's like nostalgia for me, because I love seeing, like, I'm one of those people that loves looking at old shows from the 80s and 90s and just seeing the mistakes and just admiring them for what they are and like how that happened.
There's a mistake, but the problem with some back is before computers, it was a lot harder.
Mm-hmm.
If you want, like, there's that scene when you first see Hot Rod and the boy fishing.
Mm-hmm.
To get the reflection in the water. Because it's a transparency. Mm. What they do is they had to double expose the footage, because it was a solid opaque cell, and then they had to run it through the camera under a double exposure so that it was at an opacity.
Mm.
And by doing that, when they because you have to shoot it twice in order to get that.
Yeah.
The cell of the boy wasn't perfectly lined up from the first shot to the second shot, so you get this weird strobing double image of the boy when you zoom in on him.
Mm-hmm.
Which is just a little. That's just something that you notice because of the. It's a manual mechanical process to do that. And to make stuff glow and look like it's glowing and shining and has a bit of a luminescence to it,
mm-hmm.
you have to literally paint matting and reshoot the effects over it again and make sure that it lines up perfectly to the original cell. When you shoot it a second time and do it under the camera. Like, if you watch something like Roger Rabbit, mm-hmm. anytime a character has a highlight, a shadow, a reflection, something or mm-hmm. an opacity, like if they're looking at water or in a mirror and there's a slight opacity, that wasn't something you could just go into a computer and turn on.
It wasn't something you had to literally
run it under the camera again with the film and make sure that they didn't like if this is a frame, I can't show you because you're listening, but if people were watching it, but if the frame is even slightly off, there would be a jitter, there would be that's all mm. like. Technically, like watching something like this movie or like Roger Rabbit,
mm-hmm.
where you're like, how the hell did they track all this shit?
Yeah, that was a lot of work.
I mean, I feel bad for the animators must have had carpal tunnel by the end of this movie because they're drawing things transforming and explosions and guns and robots fighting.
Mm-hmm.
And
they have to keep track a lot of stuff.
Right, and then mm-hmm. stuff had to be on the same layer too, because the more layers of cell you have, mm-hmm. there's a cell thickness and that makes shadows and it doesn't shoot properly and there's a jitter. They had to like animate perfectly, like mm-hmm. in perspective, these what looks like beautiful perspective, but if you look at them probably by themselves, they don't look too great.
Right.
But when in moving, they look really perfect.
Yeah.
And they have to match that all together. Mm-hmm. It blows me away, the amount of effort. And then the poor cameramen who mm-hmm. have to look at a sheet that lists, okay, we have an explosion and this and that and so forth on this layer. And then we have a ship that's moving in the background. And then we have stars. And then we have guns and lasers and people running. And you have to track that all on a piece of paper. And
it's
kind of
like
sure...
having, like, you know, when stop motion, if you have like a bunch of characters in the background that are moving along with the main focus action.
You have to keep track.
You have
of
to
all
keep
that.
Track of everything. It's right. Like, but you have to remember these characters are moving here, and these characters are moving here, and then you have to remember that there's a main action, and then above that, there's also some special effects.
And this
that
movie
we're
is all action. This is like the Mad Max Fury Road of animated yeah. movies, where it's just action every 2 minutes.
I admire for it. Yeah. It's like I there's a lot of movies where I'm just like, I mean, there's one moment where there's the breathing room, which I feel is the Optimus scene.
Or the scene where the fucking boy puts on that stupid suit and he's falling
Dad's
on his face.
Dad's exosuit. He told me
all
Notice
about how much
it.
We focused on the human characters in this
Try spinning. Movie. That's a neat trick. That's what it sounds. That line
it's
sounds.
Working. It's working. Yeah, you ever notice? I don't even know because I know there's a new Transformers series that they make that's on Cartoon Network. Mm-hmm. I don't even know if there's a human character in that.
I saw a couple episodes of those. The one that was done by Warner Brothers, like
Transformers animated by where, Derek Wyatt.
It looks like it has the same kind of visual style as Teen Titans.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It's that. Yeah. That might be my favorite Transformers.
I think it's mine too. I love the style.
Yeah.
Well, here's the thing.
Stylistically, I thought it was really pretty.
I love the fact that we have been able to have so many different iterations of the Transformers that it's not just one thing.
Yeah,
it can be interpreted in different ways, and there can be different interpretations to the story, to the characters, and what have you. And I think that makes it a series that's a perfect series, honestly. It's when you can take something and make it something else while still being...
Do something completely different with some of the characters.
And it could still be like what it's meant to
be. On one side, you have Transformers. On the other side, you have Scooby-Doo, which has had 20... fucking shows in the last 45 years. Yeah.
Let me know when you guys want to do Scooby-Doo and the WrestleMania mystery.
Oh, yeah. And the Flintstones.
Thanks, Mr. Big Mac.
Sorry.
I literally think about that every time I see Fred Flintstone now. I look at fucking Flintstone vitamins in the store. Well, I can't help but hear Steve say that.
We should probably talk about the Surf's Up 2 movie. That which,
holy shit, I forgot about that.
Oh, yeah, they're just...
The WrestleMania.
For people that know, I'm a huge wrestling fan too.
Yeah,
and WWE is really trying to be this entertainment brand overall, and now they're seeping into original animated movies, crossovers with Warner Brothers, and now they're heavily involved with the unwarranted sequel to Surf's Up.
Yeah, which I found hilarious. Like, all of a sudden,
do the
digging
wrestlers
up
surf?
Surf's Up, but
in the wrestling,
do the wrestlers surf in Surf's Up?
Yes.
They're like a super.
Do they wrestle surf while surfing?
No, they don't. I don't think they wrestle at all.
This could be an entirely different podcast.
All right,
but for the time being, I think we've given a good. We've given good thoughts about the Transformers. I think it's a very good. I think it's a good movie, and I'm not just saying that because of nostalgia. Because I haven't honestly seen this movie at all.
I thought it was good, and I don't know jack fucking shit about the Transformers.
It's admirable.
Part of my choice.
And Steve, obviously, you like the movie. So.
Yeah,
him wearing his Transformers shirt as we speak.
Dare to be stupid.
It's Wreck-Gar.
Wait, it's
Wreck-Gar?
Oh, it is. He's
with
got the Fu Manchu and everything.
And the pipe nipples.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, he's got pipe nipples.
I've had this thought since...
Is it cold in here?
Since they started announcing that the Blu-ray was coming out.
Yeah.
And I was getting so hyped.
I kind of want to get a copy. I have it on DVD, but I don't... The
I
Blu-ray
watched
looks
the trailer
really nice.
Multiple times, and here's I'm not a big top 10 list person, because my opinions always fluctuate. They always change.
Yeah,
So I don't have a favorite movie, my all-time favorite movie, but now I'm starting to wonder, like, is this it? and I know it's not a perfect movie. It has so many flaws, and not just as a Transformers fan.
If you enjoy it
so
despite
flaws.
Its flaws, and you think about it constantly, it's definitely one of your favorite movies.
And I get hyped every time after the giant asshole eats the planet, and those drums kick up for the Transformers theme. Oh, my God, it's a thrill ride for me. Yeah. I'm starting to wonder, like, is this my favorite movie? I don't know.
It'll fluctuate. You'll find something better, or you'll watch something again. Because I go through stages where lately I've been looking up old movies that I saw as a kid or old specials, and then I'll watch them again. And I'll have them in the background like the following week, and I'll be like, man, I remember really, really liking this movie. Mm-hmm. I guess it's not my favorite, because then I'll find something else and then I'll move on.
It happened in my childhood all the time.
It definitely isn't We're Back. It actually is worse than I remember as a kid.
Yeah.
Transformers, since this is my first really introduction to anything real. I mean, besides, I have seen Transformers animated.
Yeah.
Which I thought was cool. I didn't see all of it. I only saw some, like, maybe like 10 episodes. And I'm like, this is cool. I like the characters a lot.
Yeah.
But then, this is my really technically my introduction to
I honestly started watching G1 again, and my friend Phelous, who just made a top 20 list of the dumbest moments in the series, I'm starting to like, it's hilarious.
Oh yeah,
just the moments that happen in it. It's like it's a TV show. He did the same thing for the Ninja Turtles show, which I thought was hilarious as well, because I just had watched all of those episodes and I was like, yeah, that was pretty dumb.
Yeah, I mean,
it is hilarious in the way that there are good moments to the show, and then there's like really. It's like they couldn't think of anything else in this moment.
I don't think I could go back and watch anymore. And to be honest, like, I watched most of the series once I saw this movie. I started getting those DVDs, and I was still enjoying it. But now, that's over 10 years ago.
Right, yeah.
I'm afraid to even watch the episodes I liked.
Well, I have to be in a certain mood to watch these movies. Yeah. If I'm ready to sit through a show that I know is like not as great as I remember it being, I better be ready to just like sit down and watch it.
This movie,
that's how I was like.
I realize it still it means more to me because just like the existence of this movie brings some memories. Like I have a childhood friend, you know, who we've reconnected in our adulthood, and he's a huge Transformers fan. Mm-hmm. He's like the only person to talk to about it.
Yeah.
I remember one time I was not having the best week, and I was still living in New York, and he's living in Brooklyn, and he's like, hey, this theater in Brooklyn has an original 35mm copy of Transformers the movie. You gotta come and see it. And I was like, but I don't live in the city. I don't have a place to stay. He's like, dude, you'll stay with me. Come on, come in. I'm like, okay. We proceeded to get drunk off our ass and then go to this run to the theater because we're running late because we're too busy getting drunk. And, of course, he gets chewed out by a woman sitting next to us because he doesn't shut up during the movie and quotes the entire damn thing. And that was one of the best nights of my life.
Yeah.
And it's just a movie. I couldn't even remember necessarily watching the movie in the theater. It's just the experience of it. I'm always going to be connected to this movie.
Even, even was in Brooklyn?
This was Nighthawk Cinema.
Oh, man.
You know.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah. One of the best moments of my life, just because I don't know, it's this movie, it's reconnected me with a childhood friend of mine, too. Yeah. It's just
and that's what you should take out of it, honestly. Mm-hmm. So, that's our review of the Transformers movie. I'm gonna like close this out with Steve. You also have a podcast,
tons.
if you would like to, plug your shows.
Of course.
Please, by all means.
The most consistent one is I am a co-host on the One Piece podcast. If you happen to be in the complete opposite direction, also a fan of the phenomenon that is One Piece, the manga and anime, I am a co-host on that. It's a weekly podcast.
Yeah, I listen to this podcast, and I have to say it's fairly entertaining. I mean, it's a lengthy podcast each week, considering the subject matter, which is just like, I mean, you recap the newest chapter of the One Piece every week, and also the anime, which also has a couple episodes, and then you also do like theories and news. There's a lot
to talk about with One Piece,
and when I was listening to it, it's like I was kind of shocked about that. So, but it's a fairly fun podcast.
We've been going over going over 7 years now.
So
this podcast,
definitely look that up. It's One Piece podcast, right?
Yes. One Piece podcast. And also, I have a couple spinoffs of my own that I have to update. I've just been super busy. I do Endless Schmaltz, which is a podcast that I like to call just going back and watching shows from our past and see how well they still hold up. Currently just going through the anime series Gundam Wing, but I always thought like one day I'm gonna probably talk about Transformers, but we'll see how it happens. And I also do a show called 20 Minutes of Bullshit with my friend Alex, and that's just kind of just the shoot the shit for around 20 minutes or so. That's what I do. And also, I'm just an artist. You could find me.
Yes. Tell us where we can find you.
Yeah, just it's so easy to find me because everything is just my name, Steve Yurko, on Twitter, at Steve Yurko, Instagram and Tumblr, just Steve Yurko.
Yeah.
I am super easy to find. Deliberately.
Yeah. Awesome. And you can find us, Animated Anarchy, on our Facebook page, which is facebook.com/AnimatedAnarchyCast. That's probably the best way you can get a hold of us. and send us questions or discuss things and when we upload a new episode. But, Mike, I also would like to say that we have a P.O. box that where you can send us stuff if you would like. That's completely on your own volition. If you would like to write us a letter, I know that we like to read letters and stuff like that whenever we can get them. So
I like reading.
So, give us a letter. We could read that on the show. We can discuss whatever we get or whatever things that you want to show us. And you can go to that and write to Animated Anarchy, P.O. Box 10. Oh, God. 10. Okay. P.O. Box 10852, Burbank, California, 91510. Again, that's P.O. Box 10852, or 10852, Burbank, California, 91510. So
I want to see someone actually write to you guys. I want someone take that time. That'd be amazing.
Yeah. if you actually know the medium of actual media, please write to us. So
you own a pen.
Yeah. So, if you want to do that, feel free. We could, make something up with that. Mike, where can people find you?
I'm on Twitter.
Yeah.
And Tumblr.
Mm-hmm.
From time to time. But it's just michaeljruocco.tumblr.com.
Mm-hmm.
And I post, I'm animating more in TV Paint.
Yeah.
So I'm animating some tests and things.
But you're having a blast on it.
Yeah, it's fun. And my Twitter is at a guy who draws.
Yep.
It's not my first choice.
Easy to find him, though.
Yeah. Easy to find.
Who's that guy that draws?
Him.
And you can find me on Twitter. I'm at AWDTWIT. That's AWDTWIT. And I am also on Tumblr, AWDPlace.tumblr.com.
Where you can watch Andrew draw things like Jiminy Glicket. Do it!
Oh, boy. So, yeah.
Our coworkers even want you to do it now.
No, not at all.
About
that. Anyway,
so many tangents in this episode.
So yes, that was our podcast on Transformers movie. I hope you enjoyed. I'm Andrew.
I'm Mike,
and we were with
Steve.
Yay! And thank you so much for listening. We will see you next time. Bye-bye.
Bye.
To all.